continue reading Bhagavad Gita as it is by A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, Bhagavad Gita, Chapter 4, Transcendental Knowledge. Bhagavad Gita, Chapter 4, Text 1, Shri Bhagavan Uvacha, Imam Vishvati Yogam Proktavan Aham Abhayam Vivashwan Manave Praha Manur Iksva Kave Abravit. Translation and Prabhupada. The Personality of Godhead, Lord Sri Krishna said, I instructed this imperishable science of yoga to the Sun God Vivashwan, and Vivashwan instructed it to Manu, the father of mankind, and Manu in turn instructed it to Ikshvaku. Herein we find the history of the Bhagavad Gita traced from a remote time when it was delivered to the royal order of all planets, beginning from the Sun planet. The kings of all planets are especially meant for the protection of the inhabitants. Therefore, the royal order should understand the science of Bhagavad Gita in order to be able to rule the citizens and protect them from material bondage to lust. Human life is meant for cultivation of spiritual knowledge in eternal relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and the executive heads of all states and all planets are obliged to impart this lesson to the citizens by education, culture, and devotion. In other words, the executive heads of all states are intended to spread the science of Krishna consciousness so that the people may take advantage of this great science and pursue a successful path, utilizing the opportunity of the human form of life. In this millennium, the Sun God is known as Vivashwan, the King of the Sun, which is the origin of all planets within the solar system. In the Brahma Samhita 5.52, it is stated, Yat Chakshur Esa Savita Sakla Graha Nam Raja Samasta Sura Murtir Asesa Teja Yas Yajna Brahmati Samprata Kala Chakro Govindamadi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. Let me worship Lord Brahma, said the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Govinda Krishna, who is the origin person and under whose order the Sun, which is the king of all planets, is assuming immense power and heat. The Sun represents the eye of the Lord and traverses its orbit in obedience to its order. The Sun is the king of the planets, and the Sun God, at present of the name Vivashwan, rules the Sun planet, which is controlling all other planets by supplying heat and light. He is rotating under the order of Krishna, and Lord Krishna originally made Vivashwan his first disciple to understand the science of Gita, Bhagavad Gita. The Gita is not therefore a speculative treatise for the insignificant mundane scholar, but is a standard book of knowledge coming down from time immemorial. In the Mahabharata Santi Parva 348.51.52, we can trace out the history of the Gita as follows. Treta yagadau cha tato vivashwan manave dadau manuscha loka vrityartham sutayek sa va kave dadau Ikshvakuna chakati tho vyapta lokan avastitaha. In the beginning of the millennium known as Treta Yuga, this science of the relationship with the Supreme was delivered by Vivashwan to Manu. Manu, being the father of mankind, gave it to his son Maharaj Ikshvaku, the king of this earth planet and forefather of the Raghu dynasty, in which Lord Ramchandra appeared. Therefore, Bhagavad Gita existed in human society from time of Maharaj Ikshvaku. At the present moment, we have just passed through 5,000 years of the Kali Yuga, which lasts 432,000 years. Before this, there was Dwapar Yuga, 800,000 years. And before that, there was a Treta Yuga, 1,200,000 years. Thus, some 2,500,000 years ago, Manu spoke the Bhagavad Gita to his disciple and son Maharaj Ikshvaku, the king of this planet Earth. The age of the current Manu is calculated to last some 305,300,000 years, of which 120,400,000 have passed. Accepting that before the birth of Manu, the Gita was spoken by the Lord to his disciple, the Sun God Vivashwan. A rough estimate is that the Gita was spoken at least 120,400,000 years ago. 120,400,000 years ago, and in human society it has been extant for 2 million years. It was re-spoken by the Lord again to Arjuna about 5,000 years ago. That is the rough estimate of the history of the Gita, according to the Gita itself and according to the version of the speaker, Lord Shri Krishna. It was spoken to the sun god Vivaswan because he was also a Kshatriya and is the father of all Kshatriyas, who are descendants of the sun god or the Surya Vamsa Kshatriyas. Because Bhagavad Gita is as good as the Vedas, being spoken by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, this knowledge is Apaurusheya, superhuman, since the Vedic instructions are accepted as they are without human interpretation. The Gita must therefore be accepted without mundane interpretation. The mundane wranglers may speculate on the Gita in their own ways, but that is not Bhagavad Gita as it is. Therefore, Bhagavad Gita has to be accepted as it is from the disciplic succession. And it is described here in that the Lord spoke to the sun god, the sun god spoke to his son Manu, and Manu spoke to his son Ikshvaku. Evam parampra praptam imam raj rasyo vidhu sa kalena mahata yoga nasta parantapa. This supreme science was thus received through the chain of disciplic succession, and the saintly kings understood it in that way. But in course of time the succession was broken, and therefore the science as it is appears to be lost. It is clearly stated that the Gita was especially meant for the saintly kings because they were to execute its purpose in ruling over the citizens. Certainly Bhagavad Gita was never meant for the demonic persons who would dissipate its value for one's benefit and would devise all types of interpretations according to personal whims. As soon as the original purpose was scattered by the motives of the unscrupulous commentators, there arose the need to re-establish the disciplic succession. 5,000 years ago, it was detected by the Lord Himself that the disciplic succession was broken, and therefore He declared that the purpose of the Gita appeared to be lost. In the same way, at the present moment, also there are so many editions of the Gita, especially in English, but almost all of them are not according to authorized disciplic succession. There are innumerable interpretations rendered by different mundane scholars, but almost all of them do not accept the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna. Although they make a good business on the words of Sri Krishna, this spirit is demonic, because demons do not believe in God but simply enjoy the property of the Supreme. Since there is a great need of an edition of the Gita in English as it is received by the Parampara disciplic succession system, an attempt is made herewith to fulfill this great want. Bhagavad Gita accepted as it is a great boon to humanity. But if it is accepted as a treatise of philosophical speculations, it is simply a waste of time. Sa evayam maya tedya yogto yoga prokta puratana bhakto sime sakha cheti rahasyam hi etad uttamam. That very ancient science of this relationship with the Supreme is today told by me to you because you are my devotee as well as my friend and can therefore understand the transcendental mystery of this science. There are two classes of men, namely the devotee and the demon. The Lord selected Arjuna as the recipient of this great science owing to his being a devotee of the Lord. But for the demon, it is not possible to understand this great mysterious science. There are a number of editions of this great book of knowledge. Some of them have commentaries by the devotees, and some of them have commentaries by the demons. Commentation by the devotees is real, whereas that of the demons is useless. Arjuna accepts Sri Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and any commentary on the Gita following in the footsteps of Arjuna is a real devotional service to the cause of this great science. The demonic, however, do not accept Lord Krishna as he is. Instead, they concoct something about Krishna and mislead general readers from the path of Krishna's instructions. Here is a warning about such misleading paths. One should try to follow the disciplic succession from Arjuna and thus be benefited by these great signs of Bhagavata Gita. अर्जुन उवाच अपरम भवतो जन्म परम जन्म विवस्वतः कथम एतद् विज्ञानियम् त्वम् अदौ प्रोक्तवान् इति. अर्जुन सेड दि सन गॉड विवस्वान इज सीनियर बाय बर्थ टू यू. हाउ एम आई टू अंडरस्टैंड दैट इन द बिगनिंग यू इंस्ट्रक्टेड दिस साइंस टू हिम. अर्जुन इज एन एक्सेप्टेड डिवोटी ऑफ द लॉर्ड, सो हाउ कुड ही नॉट बिलीव इन कृष्णस वर्ड्स. The fact is that Arjuna is not inquiring for himself but for those who do not believe in the Supreme Personality of Godhead, or for the demons who do not like the idea that Krishna should be accepted as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. For them, only Arjuna inquires on this point, as if he were himself not aware of the Personality of Godhead or Krishna. As it will be evident from the 10th chapter, Arjuna knew perfectly well that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the fountainhead of everything, and the last word in transcendence. Of course, Krishna also appeared as the son of Devaki on this earth. How Krishna remained the same Supreme Personality of Godhead, the eternal original person, is very difficult for an ordinary man to understand. Therefore, to clarify this point, Arjuna put this question before Krishna so that he himself could speak authoritatively. That Krishna is the supreme authority is accepted by the whole world, not only at present but from time immemorial, and the demons alone reject him. Anyway, since Krishna is the authority accepted by all, Arjuna put this question before him in order that Krishna would describe himself without being depicted by the demons, who always try to distort him in a way understandable to the demons and their followers. It is necessary that everyone, for his own interest, know the science of Krishna. Therefore, when Krishna himself speaks about himself, it is auspicious for all the worlds to the demons. Such explanations by Krishna himself may appear to be strange, because the demons always study Krishna from their own standpoint. But those who are devotees heartily welcome the statements of Krishna when they are spoken by Krishna himself. The devotees will always worship such authoritative statements of Krishna because they are always eager to know more and more about him. The atheists who consider Krishna an ordinary man may in this way come to know that Krishna is superhuman, that he is Sachidananda Vigraha, the eternal form of bliss and knowledge, that he is transcendental, and that he is above the domination of the modes of material nature and above the influence of time and space. A devotee of Krishna like Arjuna is undoubtedly above any misunderstanding of the transcendental position of Krishna. Arjuna's putting this question before the Lord is simply an attempt by the devotee to defy the atheistic attitude of persons who consider Krishna to be an ordinary human being, subject to the modes of material nature. Sri Bhagwan Uvacha Bahuni me vaititani janmani tapcha Arjuna tani aham ved sarvani na tum ved parantapa. The Personality of God had said, many, many births both you and I have passed. I can remember all of them, but you cannot, O subduer of the enemy. In the Brahma Samhita 5.33, we have information of many, many incarnations of the Lord. It is stated there, Advaitam Achyutam Anadim Ananta Rupam Adhyan Puran Purusham Navayo Varnam Cha Vedesu Durlabham Adurlabham Atma Bhakto Govindam Adi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. I worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Govinda Krishna, who is the original person, absolute, infallible, without beginning, although expanded into unlimited forms. He is there the same original, the oldest, and the person always appearing as a fresh youth. Such eternal, blissful, all-knowing forms of the Lord are usually not understood by even the best Vedic scholars, but they are always manifest to pure, unalloyed devotees. It is also stated in Brahma Samhita 5.39, Ramadi Murtisu Kala Niyamana Tistan Nana Avatar Akrod Bhuneshu Kintu. Krishna Swayam Sambhavad Param Pumami O Govindamadi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. I worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Govinda Krishna, who is always situated in various incarnations such as Ram, Narsingha, and many sub-incarnations as well, but who is the original Personality of Godhead known as Krishna, and who incarnates personally also. In the Vedas also it is said that the Lord, although one without a second, manifests himself in innumerable forms. He is like the Vaidurya stone, which changes color yet still remains one. All those multi forms are understood by the pure unalloyed devotees, but not by a simple study of the Vedas. Vedesu durlabham adurlabham atma bhakto. Devotees like Arjuna are constant companions of the Lord, and whenever the Lord incarnates, the associate devotees also incarnate in order to serve the Lord in different capacities. Arjuna is one of these devotees, and in this verse it is understood that some millions of years ago, when Lord Krishna spoke the Bhagavad Gita to the sun god Vivashvan, Arjuna in a different capacity was also present. But the difference between the Lord and Arjuna is that the Lord remembered the incident, whereas Arjuna could not remember. That is the difference between the part and parcel living entity and the Supreme Lord. Although Arjuna is addressed herein as the mighty hero who could subdue the enemies, he is unable to recall what had happened in his various past births. Therefore, a living entity, however great he may be in the material estimation, can never equal to the Supreme Lord. Anyone who is a constant companion of the Lord is certainly a liberated person, but he cannot be equal to the Lord. The Lord is described in the Brahma Samhita as infallible Achyuta, which means that he never forgets himself even though he is in material contact. Therefore, the Lord and the living entity can never be equal in all respects. Even if the living entity is as liberated as Arjuna, although Arjuna is a devotee of the Lord, he sometimes forgets the nature of the Lord, but by the divine grace of devotee can at once understand the infallible condition of the Lord. Whereas a non-devotee or a demon cannot understand this transcendental nature. Consequently, these descriptions in the Gita cannot be understood by demonic brains. Krishna remembered acts which were performed by him millions of years before, but Arjuna could not. Despite the fact that both Krishna and Arjuna are eternal in nature, we may also note herein that a living entity forgets everything due to his change of body, but the Lord remembers because he does not change his Sachidananda body. He is Advaita, which means there is no distinction between his body and himself. Everything in relation to him is spirit, whereas the conditioned soul is different from his material body, and because the Lord's body and self are identical, his position is always different from that of an ordinary living entity. Even when he descends to this material platform, the demons cannot adjust themselves to the transcendental nature of the Lord, which the Lord himself explains in the following verse. Ajo api san avyayatma bhutanam isvaropi san prakritim swam adhisthaya sambhavami atma mayaya. Although I am unborn and my transcendental body never deteriorates, and although I am the Lord of all living entities, I still appear in every millennium in my original transcendental form. The Lord has spoken about the peculiarities of his birth. Although he may appear like an ordinary person, he remembers everything of his many past births, whereas a common man cannot remember what he has done even a few hours before. If someone is asked what he did exactly at the same time one day earlier, it would be very difficult for a common man to answer immediately. He would surely have to dredge his memory to recall what he was doing exactly at the same time one day before. And yet, men often dare claim to be God or Krishna. One should not be misled by such meaningless claims. Then again, the Lord explains his prakriti or his form. Prakriti means nature, as well as sorupa or one's own form. The Lord says that he appears in his own body. He does not change his body, as the common living entity changes from one body to another. The conditioned soul may have one kind of body in the present birth, but he has a different body in the next birth. In the material world, the living entity has no fixed body but transmigrates from one body to another. The Lord, however, does not do so. Whenever he appears, he does so in the same original body by his internal potency. In other words, Krishna appears in this material world in his original eternal form with two hands holding a flute, He appears exactly in his eternal body, uncontaminated by this material world. Although he appears in the same transcendental body and is Lord of the universe, it still appears that he takes his birth like an ordinary living entity. And although his body does not deteriorate like a material body, it still appears that Lord Krishna grows from childhood to boyhood, from boy to youth. But astonishingly enough, that he never ages beyond youth. At the time of the battle of Kurukshetra, he had many grandchildren at home. Or in other words, he had sufficiently aged by material calculations. Still, he looked just like a young man, 20-25 years old. We never see a picture of Krishna in old age because he never grows old like us, although he is the oldest person in the whole creation, past, present and future. Neither his body nor his intelligence ever deteriorates or changes. Therefore, it is clear that in spite of his being in the material world, he is the same unborn eternal form of bliss and knowledge, changeless in his transcendental body and intelligence. Factually, his appearance and disappearance are like the sun's arising, moving before us and then disappearing from our eyesight. When the sun is out of sight, we think that the sun has set, and when the sun is before our eyes, we think that the sun is on the horizon. Actually, the sun is always in its fixed position. But owing to our defective, insufficient senses, we calculate the appearance and disappearance of the sun in the sky. And because Lord Krishna's appearance and disappearance are completely different from that of any ordinary, common living entity, it is evident that he is eternal, blissful knowledge by his internal potency. And he is never contaminated by material nature. The Vedas also confirm that the Supreme Personality of Godhead is unborn, yet he still appears to take his birth in multi-manifestations. The Vedic supplementary literatures are also confirm that even though the Lord appears to be taking his birth, he is still without change of body. In the Bhagavatam, he appears before his mother as Narayana with four hands and the decorations of the six kinds of full appearances. His appearance in his original eternal form is his causeless mercy bestowed upon the living entities so that they can concentrate on the Supreme Lord as he is and not on mental concoctions or imaginations, which the impersonalist wrongly thinks the Lord's form to be. The word Maya or Atma Maya refers to the Lord's causeless mercy according to the Vishwakosha dictionary. The Lord is conscious of all of his previous appearances and disappearances, but a common living entity forgets everything about his past body as soon as he gets another body. He is the Lord of all living entities because he performs wonderful and superhuman activities while he is on this earth. Therefore, the Lord is always the same absolute truth and is without differentiation between his form and self, or between his quality and body. A question may now be raised as to why the Lord appears and disappears in this world. This is explained in the next verse. Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyutthanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijami ham. Whenever and wherever there is a decline in religious practice, O descendant of Bharata, and a predominant rise of irreligion, at that time I descend myself. The word Srijami is significant herein. Srijami cannot be used in the sense of creation because according to the previous verse, there is no creation of the Lord's form or body, since all of the forms are eternally existent. Therefore, Srijami means that the Lord manifests himself as he is. Although the Lord appears on a schedule, namely at the end of the Dwapar Yuga of the 28th millennium of the 7th Manu in one day of Brahma, he has no obligation to adhere to such rules and regulations because he is completely free to act in many ways as his will. He therefore appears by his own will whenever there is a predominance of irreligiosity and a disappearance of true religion. Principles of religion are laid down in the Vedas, and any discrepancy in the matter of properly executing the rules of the Vedas makes one irreligious. In the Bhagavatam, it is stated that such principles are the laws of the Lord. Only the Lord can manufacture a system of religion. The Vedas are also accepted as originally spoken by the Lord Himself to Brahma from within His heart. Therefore, the principles of dharma or religion are the direct orders of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Dharmam tu saksat bhagavat pranitam. These principles are clearly indicated throughout the Bhagavad Gita. The purpose of the Vedas is to establish such principles under the order of the Supreme Lord, and the Lord directly orders at the end of the Gita that the highest principle of religion is to surrender unto Him only and nothing more. The Vedic principles push one towards complete surrender unto Him, and whenever such principles are disturbed by the demonic, the Lord appears from the Bhagavatam. We understand that Lord Buddha is the incarnation of Krishna, who appeared when materialism was rampant and materialists were using the pretext of the authority of the Vedas. Although there are certain restrictive rules and regulations regarding animal sacrifice for particular purposes in the Vedas, people of demonic tendency still took animal sacrifice without reference to the Vedic principles. Lord Buddha appeared in order to stop this nonsense and to establish the Vedic principles of non-violence. Therefore, each and every avatar or incarnation of the Lord has a particular mission, and they are all described in the revealed scriptures. No one should be accepted as an avatar unless he is referred to be by scriptures. It is not a fact that the Lord appears only on Indian soil. He can manifest Himself anywhere and everywhere. And whenever He desires to appear in each and every incarnation, He speaks as much about religion as can be understood by the particular people under their particular circumstances. But the mission is the same, to lead people to God consciousness and obedience to the principles of religion. Sometimes He descends personally, and sometimes He sends His bona fide representative in the form of His son or servant or Himself in some disguised form. The principles of the Bhagavad Gita was spoken to Arjuna, and for that matter to other highly elevated persons, because he was highly advanced compared to ordinary persons in other parts of the world. 2 + 2 = 4 is a mathematical principle that is true in the beginner's arithmetic class and in the advanced class as well. Still, there are higher and lower mathematics. In all incarnations of the Lord, therefore, the same principles are taught, but they appear to be higher and lower in varied circumstances. The higher principles of religion begin with the acceptance of the four orders and the four statuses of social life, as will be explained later. The whole purpose of the mission of incarnation is to arouse Krishna consciousness everywhere. Such consciousness is manifest and non-manifest only under different circumstances. Paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha duruskritam dharma samasthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. To deliver the pious and to annihilate the miscreants, as well as to re-establish the principles of religion, I myself appear millennium after millennium. According to Bhagavad Gita, a sadhu, holy man, is a man in Krishna consciousness. A person may appear to be irreligious, but if he has the qualifications of Krishna consciousness wholly and fully, he is to be understood to be a sadhu, and duskritam applies to those who do not care for Krishna consciousness. Such miscreants or duskritam are described as foolish and the lowest of mankind. Even though they may be decorated with mundane education, whereas a person who is 100% engaged in Krishna consciousness is accepted as a sadhu, even though such a person may be neither learned nor well cultured. As far as the atheistic are concerned, it is not necessary for the Supreme Lord to appear as He is to destroy them, as He did with the demons Ravana and Kamsa. The Lord has many agents who are quite competent to vanquish demons. But the Lord especially descends to appease His unalloyed devotees, who are always harassed by the demonic. The demon harasses the devotee, even though the latter may happen to be his kin. Although Prahlad Maharaj was the son of Hiranyakashipu, he was nonetheless persecuted by his father. Although Devaki, the mother of Krishna, was the sister of Kamsa, she and her husband Vasudev were persecuted only because Krishna was to be born of them. So Lord Krishna appeared primarily to deliver Devaki rather than kill Kamsa. But both were performed simultaneously. Therefore, it is said here that to deliver the devotee and vanquish the demon miscreants, the Lord appears in different incarnations. In the Chaitanya Charitamrita of Krishnadas Kaviraj, the following verses, Madhya Lila 20-263-264, summarize the principles of incarnation. Srishti hetu ei murti prapanchi avatare, sei ishwarya ishwara, murti avatar namadhare, mayatita prabhayoma sabar avasthane, vishve avatari dhare avatar nama. The avatar or incarnation of Godhead descends from the kingdom of God for material manifestation. And the particular form of the personality of Godhead who so descends is called an incarnation or avatar. Such incarnations are situated in the spiritual world, the kingdom of God. When they descend to the material creation, they assume this name avatar. There are various kinds of avatars such as Purusavataras, Gunavataras, Lilavataras, Saktya Ves Avataras, Avataras, Manavantar Avataras, and Yuga Avataras, all appearing on the schedule all over the universe. But Lord Krishna is their primeval Lord, the fountainhead of all avatars. Lord Shri Krishna descends for the specific purpose of mitigating the anxieties of the pure devotees who are very anxious to see him in his original Vrindavan pastimes. Therefore, the prime purpose of the Krishna avatar is to satisfy his unalloyed devotees. The Lord says that he incarnates himself in every millennium. This indicates that he incarnates also in the age of Kali, as stated in the Srimad Bhagavatam. The incarnation in the age of Kali is Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who spread the worship of Krishna by the Sankirtan movement, congregational chanting of the holy names, and spread Krishna consciousness throughout India. He predicted that this culture of Sankirtan would be broadcast all over the world. From town to town, village to village, Lord Chaitanya as the incarnation of Krishna, the personality of Godhead, is described secretly but not directly in the confidential parts of the revealed scriptures such as the Upanishads, Mahabharata and Bhagavatam. The devotees of Lord Krishna are very much attracted by the Sankirtan movement of Lord Chaitanya. This avatar of the Lord does not kill the miscreants but delivers them by his causeless mercy. Janma karma chame divyam evam yo veti tattvatah tyakta deham puna janma naiti mam eti so Arjuna. One who knows the transcendental nature of my appearance and activities does not, upon leaving the body, take his birth again in this material world, but attains my eternal abode, O Arjuna. The Lord's descent from this transcendental abode is already explained in the 6th verse. One who can understand the truth of the appearance of the personality of Godhead is already liberated from material bondage, and therefore he returns to the kingdom of God immediately after quitting this present material body. Such a liberation of the living entity from material bondage is not all easy. The impersonalists and the yogis attain a liberation only after much trouble and many, many births. Even then, the liberation achieved merging into the impersonal Brahma Jyoti of the Lord is only partial, and there is the risk of returning to this material world. But the devotee, simply by understanding the transcendental nature of the body and activities of the Lord, attains the abode of the Lord after ending this body and does not run the risk of returning to this material world. In the Brahma Samhita 5.33, it is stated that the Lord has many, many forms and incarnations, Advaitam, Achyutam, Anadim, Ananta, Rupam. Although there are many transcendental forms of the Lord, they are still one and the same Supreme Personality of Godhead. One has to understand this fact with conviction. Although it is incomprehensible to mundane scholars and empiric philosophers, stated in the Vedas, Purusha Bodhini Upanishad, Eko Devo Nitya Lilanurukto Bhakta Vyapi Hide Antara Atmana Atma. The one Supreme Personality of Godhead is eternally engaged in many, many transcendental forms in relationships with his unalloyed devotees. This Vedic version is confirmed in this verse of the Gita personally by the Lord. He who accepts this truth on the strength of the authority of the Vedas and of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and who does not waste time in philosophical speculations, attains their highest perfectional stage of liberation. Simply by accepting this truth on faith, one can without a doubt attain liberation. The Vedic version Tat Tvam Asi is actually applied in this case. Anyone who understands Lord Krishna to be the Supreme, or who says unto the Lord, "You are the same Supreme Brahman, the personality of Godhead," is certainly liberated instantly, and consequently his entrance into the transcendental association of the Lord is guaranteed. In other words, such a faithful devotee of the Lord attains perfection, and this is confirmed by the following Vedic assertion. Tam eva vidit vati mrityum eti nanya pantha vidyate yanaya. One can attain the perfect stage of liberation from birth and death simply by knowing the Lord, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and there is no other way to achieve this perfection. Svetasvatara Upanishad 3.8, that there is no alternative, means that anyone who does not understand Lord Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead is surely in the mode of ignorance, and consequently he will not attain salvation simply, so to speak, by licking the outer surface of the bottle of honey, or by interpreting this Bhagavad Gita according to mundane scholarship. Such empiric philosophers may assume very important roles in the material world, but they are not necessarily eligible for liberation. Such puffed up mundane scholars have to wait for the causeless mercy of the Lord, of the devotee of the Lord. One should therefore cultivate Krishna consciousness with faith and knowledge, and in this way attain perfection. Vita rag bhaya krodha man maya mat upashritaha bhava jnana tapasa putamad bhavam agata. Being freed from attachment, fear and anger, being fully absorbed in me and taking refuge in me, many persons in the past became purified by knowledge of me, and thus they all attained transcendental love for me. As described above, it is very difficult for a person who is too materially affected to understand the personal nature of the Supreme Absolute Truth. Generally, people who are attached to the bodily conception of life are so absorbed in materialism that it is almost impossible for them to understand how the Supreme can be a person. Such materialists cannot even imagine that there is a transcendental body which is imperishable, full of knowledge, and eternally blissful. In the materialistic concept, the body is perishable, full of ignorance, and completely miserable. Therefore, people in general keep this same bodily idea in mind when they are informed of the personal form of the Lord. For such materialistic man, the form of the gigantic manifestation is supreme. Consequently, they consider the Supreme to be impersonal, and because they are too materially absorbed, the conception of retaining the personality after liberation from matter frightens them. When they are informed that spiritual life is also individual and personal, they become afraid of becoming persons again, and so they naturally prefer a kind of merging into the impersonal void. Generally, they compare the living entities to be the bubbles of the ocean, which merge into the ocean. That is the highest perfection of spiritual existence, attainable without individual personality. This is a kind of fearful stage of life, devoid of perfect knowledge of spiritual existence. Furthermore, there are many persons who cannot understand spiritual existence at all. Being embarrassed by so many theories and by contradictions of various types of philosophical speculations, they become disgusted or angry and foolishly conclude that there is no supreme cause and that everything is ultimately void. Such people are in a diseased condition of life. Some people are too materially attached and therefore do not give attention to spiritual life. Some of them want to merge into the supreme spiritual cause, and some of them disbelieve in everything, being angry at all sorts of spiritual speculations out of hopelessness. This last class of men take to the shelter of some kind of intoxication, and their effective hallucinations are sometimes accepted as spiritual vision. One has to get rid of all three stages of material consciousness: attachment to material life, fear of a spiritual personal identity, and the conception of void that arises from frustration in life. To get free from these three stages of the material concept of life, one has to take complete shelter of the Lord, guided by the bona fide spiritual master, and follow the disciplines and regulative principles of devotional life. The last stage of the devotional life is called bhava or transcendental love of Godhead. According to Bhakti Rasami Sindhu 1.4.15.16, the signs of devotional service, adhau shraddha tatha sadhu sangha atha bhajana kriya tatha anartha nivritti sya tato nistha ruchis tatha atha saktis tato bhavas tatha primabhya danchati sada kan ayukta premna pradurbhave bhavit kramaha. In the beginning, one must have a preliminary desire for self-realization. This will bring one to the stage of trying to associate with the persons who are spiritually elevated. In the next stage, one becomes initiated by an elevated spiritual master, and under his instructions, the neophyte devotee begins the process of devotional service. By execution of devotional service under the guidance of the spiritual master, one becomes free from all material attachment, attains steadiness in self-realization, and acquires a taste for hearing about the Absolute Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna. This taste leads one further forward to attachment for Krishna consciousness, which is matured in bhava, or the preliminary stage of transcendental love of God. Real love for God is called prema, the highest perfectional stage of life. In the prema stage, there is constant engagement in the transcendental loving service of the Lord. So by the slow process of devotional service under the guidance of the bona fide spiritual master, one can attain the highest stage, being free from all material attachment, from the fearfulness of one's individual spiritual personality, and from the frustrations that result in void philosophy. Then one can ultimately attain to the abode of the Supreme Lord. Yayatha mam prapadyante tam sataiva bhajami aham mama vartamanu vartante manusya partha sarvasa. As all surrender unto me, I reward them accordingly. Everyone follows my path in all respects, O son of Pritha. Everyone is searching for Krishna in different aspects of his manifestations. Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is partially realized in his impersonal Brahma Jyotir effulgence, and as the all-pervading Supersoul dwelling within everything, including the particles of atoms. But Krishna is fully realized only by his pure devotees. Consequently, Krishna is the object of everyone's realization, and thus anyone and everyone is satisfied according to one's desire to have him. In the transcendental world, also Krishna reciprocates with his pure devotees in the transcendental attitude. Just as the devotee wants him, one devotee may want Krishna as the Supreme Master, another as his personal friend, another as his son, and still another as his lover. Krishna rewards all the devotees equally, according to their different intensities of love for him. In the material world, the same reciprocations of feeling are there, and they are equally exchanged by the Lord with different types of worshippers. The pure devotees both here and in the transcendental abode associate with him in person and are able to render personal service to the Lord and thus derive transcendental bliss in his loving service. As for those who are impersonalists and who want to commit spiritual suicide by annihilating the individual existence of the living entity, Krishna helps also by absorbing them into his effulgence. Such impersonalists do not agree to accept the eternal blissful personality of Godhead. Consequently, they cannot relish the bliss of transcendental personal service to the Lord. Having extinguished their individuality, some of them who are not firmly situated even in the impersonal existence return to this material field to exhibit their dormant desires for activities. They are not admitted into the spiritual planets, but they are again given a chance to act on the material planets. For those who are fruitive workers, the Lord awards the desired result of their prescribed duties as the Yajneshwara, and those who are yogis seeking mystic powers are awarded such powers. In other words, everyone is dependent for success upon his mercy alone, and all kinds of spiritual processes are but different degrees of success on the same path. Unless therefore one comes to the highest perfection of Krishna consciousness, all attempts remain imperfect. As is stated in Bhagavatam 2.3.10, Akama sarva kama va moksha kama udaridi tivrena bhakti yogena yajate purusam param. Whether one is without desire, the condition of the devotees, or is desirous of all fruitive results, always after liberation, one should with all efforts try to worship the Supreme Personality of Godhead for complete, perfect, culminating in Krishna consciousness. Kang santa karmanam siddhi mejante hiya devata sipram hi manusya loke siddhir bhavati karmaja. Men in this world desire success in fruitive activities and therefore they worship the demigods quickly. Of course, men get results from fruitive work in this world. There is a great misconception about the gods and the demigods of this material world. And men of less intelligence, although passing as great scholars, take these